Amen. Praise the Lord. I got a good work going, and was happy to make an exception this evening and just take a minute tonight and give them an opportunity to talk about the work that they have going on there. So we've kind of known Mickey and Trina from a distance for a number of years. It's easy to tell them apart because Mickey's the one with the beard, and we're glad to have him with us now and get opportunity to kind of reestablish some fellowship with them and spend some time with them just very briefly while they're here. So if you have your Bible with you, we're going to have you turn. I think we're starting off tonight in the book of Matthew. We're going to be looking at the sixth of the seven crises in the life of Christ as we've gone through the life of Christ together, Matthew chapter 21. And as you're turning there and kind of getting everything settled in, and just before we pray, just to let you know, this particular week, the quiz, if you're taking this for credit, or you're auditing and wanna do it, the quiz this week is actually over a map. So you got to go online. You have to get the map. You have to locate where everything's at on the map. So it's a map test and a map quiz this week, and then next Sunday is our last Sunday in the life of Christ together. We'll look at the seventh and final crisis in the life of Christ. And so we've been 14 weeks at this, and next Sunday will be the last one. The Sunday after that is when your book review is due, your book report is due on the assigned textbook that we had given. So just minutes on housekeeping items there. Let's have a word of prayer, and we'll get to looking at the life of Christ together. Father, we thank you. Thank you again that we can come before you tonight, Lord. We can look at the life of Christ together, because, Lord, as we look tonight at this seventh crisis having to do with the cross, Lord, we thank you because the timing is so exquisite. The timing is so perfect because it is only the cross that explains the importance of the crib. The crib really has no importance and doesn't mean anything without the cross. And so, Father, we ask that you would help us tonight as we join you in this walk of suffering and look at your passion for us in suffering for our sins and all that it meant. We ask it tonight in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Okay, Matthew chapter 21, if you have your Bible. In the ancient world, a Roman triumph was a spectacle and a celebration. It was a parade that was held in the city of Rome for a returning general who had prosecuted a successful war or was victorious in some important battle. And it was granted by the Senate on behalf of the people and to remind them of the glory of Rome and its exceptionalism as a state. American exceptionalism stems from that idea that our history is unique among the nations and our mission is to transform the world through the spread of freedom, and that we're superior to other countries and other cultures on the planet. But because we are the new Romans, we also accord and award our heroes with an occasional triumph. And so what happens is our hero will ride through what is called the Canyon of Heroes in the financial district of New York City from Battery to City Hall, where all while being showered with shards and shreds of paper thrown from nearby buildings and a snowstorm-like flurry of celebration in what we call a ticker tape parade. And following World War II, we gave these modern Roman triumphs in honor of our victorious generals and admirals. So Eisenhower, Nimitz, MacArthur. We did it for John Glenn when he returned from the first manned orbit around the Earth in 1962. We did it for the three astronauts who first traveled to the moon and back in 1969. When Jesus entered Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, Matthew 21, verse 8 says, "And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes went before and followed and cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, "Who's this?" And the word translated move means He rocked that place. He threw it into a tremor, because that word is the word that gives us our English term seismograph. And this heralded the sixth crisis in the life of Christ, because when Jesus died on the cross, a literal earthquake occurred, as does one in the next crisis at his resurrection on resurrection morning. And so this was the final attempt of Christ the King to get his countrymen to receive his reign. Now, if you get 2 Peter chapter 3 in one hand, and just go over to Matthew 23 in your other hand. So from Matthew 21 to Matthew 23, but also 2 Peter 3. What I fear is that the spiritual understanding of the mob is no better today. People still gather at Easter and at Christmas for a celebration of Christ coming as a babe in a manger, and yet they continue to reject the reason that he came, and they refuse to hail him as their Lord and King. So let's hold the Word of God up as a mirror, and let's see how we reflect in it. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness." He's not late. He's not taking his time. He's not dilly-dallying around. "But he's long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish." All right, 2 Peter 3, 9, "The Lord is not willing." Now in Matthew 23, verse 37, Jesus stops. You know, you would think at the end of that triumph, he might give another speech that would resound to his own glory and acclaim. And instead, he stands on the top of a hill, he oversees the city of Jerusalem, and he weeps and says, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets," Matthew 23, 37, "and stonest them which are sent unto thee. How often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chicks under her wings, and ye would not. The Lord is not willing that any should perish. And yet, ye are not willing to come to him and keep from perishing." That is the tension that leads us to the sixth crisis of the Christ. God is willing one thing, but we are not. God is not willing for a certain outcome, and yet we are. And all of this is displayed in the three parts of this crisis, which are centered in three places geographically. Gethsemane, which is a garden of prayer. Gabbatha, which is a governmental place of judgment. And Golgotha, a Gothic place of execution. Now, if you'll just turn quickly to Daniel chapter 6. How apropos, human history started in a garden paradise where Adam failed us. Human history is now redeemed in a garden of pain where the last Adam prepares to fix us. And so for those who put their faith in the finished work of Christ, we are eternally blessed in a garden place, once again called paradise, in eternity. And our goal in this particular session is to start in Gethsemane, follow Jesus to Gabbatha, and take our spot in the red rain of agony at the foot of Golgotha, and learn what it must mean for us today. As the old hymn writer said, "Bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood." Hallelujah! What a Savior. Here in Daniel chapter 6, beginning verse 7, story in the life of Daniel says, "All presidents of the kingdom and governors and princes and counselors and captains, we all consulted together to establish a royal statute and make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save of thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore, King Darius signed the writing and the decree. Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled down upon his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime." Now turn to Matthew chapter 26, because just like Daniel, after Jesus knew that Judas was determined to betray him to those who were determined to kill him, then Jesus went boldly to that spot where his enemies knew that he would go in order to pray. And it's in this last grim episode among the olive trees that our champion now resists unto blood, agonizing against our sin. In Matthew 26, verse 36, then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. Gethsemane distills the medicine to cure the disease that resulted from eating the forbidden fruit. And I want you to watch now as our sin, yours and mine, changes everything about the sinless Son of Man into a solid sheet of sorrow. Verse 37, and he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. Put the shoe off from your foot as we enter the gate of the Garden of the Oil Press, because that's what the two Hebrew words, Geth, Shemen, mean when you put them together. The oil press, the place of the press used to squeeze the fat out of the olive. Verse 38, then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Peace is fled, tranquility is turned into tempest. In the soul of our Savior, he is anxious and concerned. Paul says that strong crying and tears are not able to express the agonies that he's enduring here. So I think our weak words can do little more than just give us a glimpse into his grief. After supper, they sang a hymn, but there's no singing in Gethsemane, where that phrase exceeding sorrowful, if you notice on your handout, let me hit you with this definition. That phrase exceeding sorrowful means to be surrounded and overwhelmed by your grief. Now turn to Psalm 116. In an all-around and all-encompassing and engulfing soul pain. You know, in ordinary misery, there's always some loophole of escape that you can find, some breathing space for hope. But Jesus was tested above what is common to man, and he was tortured without hope of release. His case could not be worse, as in type and in prophecy. He says here in Psalm 116, verse 3, the sorrows of death compassed me, and the pains of hell gat hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow. Now turn to Nehemiah chapter 4. Above him, keep your finger in Matthew 26, turn to Nehemiah 4. Above him, beneath him, around him, within him, outside him, billows and waves went over him. It was a deep cup that he had to drink. So he says to those closest to him in life in Matthew 26, verse 38, tarry ye here and watch with me. Now let's utilize the law of first mention. Let's look for the first place that the words watch and pray are used in the same verse. Look at Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 8. And conspired all of them together to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Nevertheless, verse 9 says, we made our prayer unto God and set a watch against them day and night because of them. Watch means to stay awake. Be alert so you can react to the enemy. Prayer means to plead in desperate dependence on God to rescue you whenever the enemy does arrive. Because here's our thesis for tonight's study. All watchmen carry weapons. So pray and stop sleepwalking. You're to watch and pray. So you got to pray, but you're also to watch. And you can watch because you got a weapon. Just like Nehemiah 4, verses 8 and 9, Jesus wants us to do the same thing today. He asked these earliest apostles to do as he sat there and stood there and kneeled there in Gethsemane. And yet his disciples could not help him. They could watch and they could pray. As it turned out, they were all sleeping except for the one who was on his way to betray him. Judas ruined a good name, because the Judas, or Judah, actually is the word for praise in the Hebrew. And he ruined a good name by rejecting God's will, but the others were resisting God's will because they didn't watch and pray. So much so that Peter ends up drawing his sword against the wrong enemy. And Jesus had to then fix that mistake so that they could get away, and only he would be taken. Jesus was sorrowing unto death, and so while he did not die in this garden, he suffered as if he had. Turn to Mark chapter 14. There was a grief that Christ could not conceal. Backward and forward he ran. We watch him go three times. He runs back to his disciples to see if they're still watching him. And I have this vision in my mind that he gets down and he prays and he sort of quiets his spirit and gets a little peace about the situation. He goes back to his disciples. He finds out they're sleeping. And then he's back anxious, in anxiety again, and has to go back and pray. And so he goes back and forth and you know, they discover his sorrow as he does this process. They see the blood in his sweat. Peter tells Mark to tell us in Mark 14, verse 33, and he taketh with him Peter and James and John and began to be sore amazed and to be very heavy. Maybe it was terror at the thought of death, like we all have. I mean, we were originally created to be immortal beings. We were created for immortality. So to die is strange work for us. It seems like if anybody should cheat death and should live forever, it should be us. God puts that in the heart of every person that's born. And obviously the presence of Satan throws shade on that, including skepticism that questions God's existence, questions creation's story. But despite the portrayal in Mel Gibson's movie, Satan is not shown as the reason for Christ's pain in Gethsemane. Putting his foot on the serpent cost Jesus a bruised heel, but that's all it was. The Gethsemane agony wounded his soul unto death. The devil didn't do that. What is it that gives this place its agony? I think it's because the Father put him to grief for us. It was here that he had to be squeezed in a press for the richness of the anointing to come out. It was here that he had to take a certain cup from the Father's hand, not from the Jews, not from that traitor Judas, not from the sleeping apostles, not from the cruel Romans, and not from the devil. He had to take it from his Father's own hand. And before any of them ever hurt him, the Father started first. This trial from the Father was a cup that was filled in his own hand, a bitter potion of grief, representing the Father's entire wrath on sin, now being put on the Son. That is what amazed his soul and troubled his heart. It was a shot glass. It was a draw more dreadful than physical pain. It was a potion more potent than his previous temptation out in the wilderness Matthew chapter 4. It was something full of dread because of what it represented. So let me hit you with this definition, because that word amazed means he was utterly astonished. He was awestruck and frightened. Turn to Isaiah chapter 53. It means to be out of your mind contemplating a certain outcome. It went to the extreme of distress, like you might get if you were told of a diagnosis of a certain terminal disease, and Christ was stricken at the sight of the sin that he was going to have to bear and what was going to be laid on him and of the vengeance due because of that sin. He was sorrowful and then depressed and then affrighted at standing in the sinner's stead before a holy God and have his Father look on him as unholy, looking on him as the guilty one, and then being forsaken by the one who was his Father from eternity. Isaiah looks 800 years into the future and sees some of that here in chapter 53 and verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. Now look at verse 12. Verse 12. Because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. He was made sin for us, 2 Corinthians 5:21. He was made a curse for us, Galatians 3:13. He was forsaken by his father for us, Matthew 27:46. Oh, what a cop! Jesus is about to carry the curse that belongs on us. So he had to be looked at by God as if he were all the sinners in all the world for all of time, and as if he had committed all the sins that we have ever committed. And it was the sin itself that overwhelmed his soul, because if he were going to stand in the sinner's stead, he would have to suffer in the sinner's spot. Turn to John chapter 12. I think you never have to be afraid of exaggeration when you talk about what Christ endured. All of hell was distilled into this crisis. It was eternal suffering, and yet it was able to be distilled down into a period of time. How? How is that? The answer is because he was an infinite person. The woe is so inconceivable, I don't think we can get any closer to him in this garden than what the apostles did. This same sorrow had afflicted the Savior 4 days before. You can read it here in John chapter 12, verse 27. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this hour came I unto this hour. That was a foretaste of the depression that put him on his face here in the garden. Our mind can enable us to conquer pain, but if your soul gets overwhelmed, it can create bodily pain. Jesus' soul sufferings were the soul of his sufferings. Matthew records for us back in Matthew 26, verse 37. And he began to be sorrowful, and he says, very heavy. Let me hit you with this definition, because very heavy is a word that means to be saturated with loathing, in fear of distress, in distress of mind, a loathing that often comes those who have lived through patterns of abuse where they hate themselves. Turn to Psalm 69 and Luke chapter 22. Psalm 69 in your left hand, Luke 22 in your right. This is a pathetic word. It means complete obsession and preoccupation with sorrow to the exclusion of any other thought. So much so that your courage is all gone. This one burning dread consumed all his strength. His position as sin bearer and his desertion by the Father engrossed him that night. He was drowning in a sea of pain. The psalmist records part of his prayer that the sleepless apostles missed that night because they were sleeping. Psalm 69, verse 1. Save me, O God, for the waters are come into my soul. I sink in deep mire where there is no standing. I come into deep waters where the floods overflow me. I am weary of my crying. My throat is dried. My eyes fail while I wait for my God. He was heavy like a boxer staggered by a sudden blow. He was sick and fainting. Therefore, when you are depressed, you can fellowship in his sufferings. Dr. Luke in Luke chapter 22 records for us how in verse 44, Luke 22:44, being in an agony, he prayed the more earnestly. Now that's opposite to us, isn't it? The more agony we get, the more we tend to walk away, stop praying, turn our back on God, be silent, isolate ourselves. No, he prayed the more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Let me hit you with this definition, because an agony is a struggle. An agony is a conflict. It is a contest. It is a wrestling match with anguish. It is the feeling of the slave before he enters the arena against the gladiator. With whom did Jesus wrestle? He wrestled with himself. The contest was not with God, because he wanted God's will. The contest was not with Satan. This was an intense combat internally within himself. Could he who knew no sin be made sin so as to bear sin for us? The purity of his heart said no. The holiness of his nature recoiled at the very suggestion. But infinite love said, bear it. Stoop. get beneath that load. There was an agony between the attributes of his nature so that a crack could be made in the Trinity. As the Son of God prepared to have the Father turn his back on him and pour out his wrath on him instead of us and squeeze us in the safety of that crack. This was conflict on a cosmic scale. You know, the worst kind of war is civil war. This was a civil war within Christ's own heart. And now the purity that could not logically, spiritually, or biblically come into contact with sin competed with the love that would not let us perish. Mercy and justice, two irresolvable attributes, were wrestled into harmony here in Gethsemane. Christ found in his own suffering the solution that allowed those two attributes to kiss. But the inner pressure made that result like oil getting squeezed out of the olives in the olive press. He tried to get help in community, in a small group meeting. They fell asleep on him, so he didn't find any help there, so he resorted to lone prayer. And after he finished each time, it seems like he grew calm with a resolved peace of mind. But let this be a lesson, because even the Son of Man had to immediately return to his place of strong crying. Maybe it was the sight of his disciples sleeping on him, whatever it was. Whatever peace he got didn't last long, and he had to go right back to praying. Turn to John chapter 15. When I wonder why God did not end my ministry a long time ago, I step into Gethsemane. I look under the limbs of those gnarled trees. I see the Savior interceding for me, taking my failures on himself. I see the soil red with the rain of his bloody sweat. I see his face smeared with the gore that is coming down. Now that the agony is past, I can understand how God could count me faithful, putting me in ministry when I'm not faithful. Now I understand grace. God cannot demand payment twice, first at the hand of his Son and then at mine. So Christ's lack of escape purchased my escape out of every possible sorrow I could come into. That is our comfort in his agony. I'm done with Matthew 26. I got to stop. But grab hold of that and never let it go. As we move on to the scenes of Gabbatha, turn to John chapter 19. John chapter 19 verse 13 says, "When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat him down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the Lithostraton." That's the word. That's the word the Romans use, the Lithostraton. I mean, it sounds like something out of one of our fantasy type movies today. It sounds like the ultimate adversary. It means the stone. The stone pavement, but in Hebrew, Gabbatha, which means the same thing. Back up one chapter to chapter 18. John chapter 18, verse 12. "Then the band and the captain and the officers of the Jews took Jesus and bound him and led him away to Annas first, for he was father-in-law to Caiaphas, which was the high priest that same year." Turn to Matthew chapter 27. Annas had been appointed by Quirinius, governor of Syria, to be the high priest in AD 7. He was deposed by Valerius Gratus in AD 15. But even though he had been removed from the high priesthood, he continued to wield power after being deposed through one of his five sons, plus through his son-in-law, Caiaphas, who did hold the high priest. So either he, his five sons, or his son-in-law held the high priesthood in almost unbroken succession during this time from the Romans. Caiaphas was a Sadducee. That means he was a skeptic of what the Bible taught. And so he did not believe in the existence of angels. He did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. But before we judge too harshly, the religious leaders of Jesus' day, maybe we ought to examine the evangelical leaders in our own churches. You know, King Ahaz visited Damascus and he saw an altar there that he admired. So he commanded his high priest to duplicate that altar from Damascus and to kick the consecrated altar of the Lord to the curb. Today we get our philosophies, we get our psychology, and we get our ideas from the world, and we think they are more scientific than the Bible. We think they're more scientific than Bible principles, so we likewise exercise our skepticism. Here in Matthew chapter 27, we watch as Jesus goes through six trials or hearings. Three are Jewish, the last three are Roman. Matthew 27, verse 27 says, "Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered them into the whole band of soldiers, and they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, 'Hail, King of the Jews!' And they spat upon him and took the reed and smote him on the head." They put a crown on his head. That crown had rubies on it because they were composed of Christ's own blood. Precious blessings forced from his forehead by the cruel thorns of those soldiers. Of all the atrocities ever witnessed by human eyes, the events at Gabbatha are the worst. Because out of Jewish religion came the demand for the crucifixion. Out of Roman power came the ability for the crucifixion. And out of Greek culture came the justification for crucifixion. So let us all stand guilty at this hill. Sinful religion rejected him. Sinful power murdered him. Sinful culture ignored him. So come here and look at the coronation that man gives to cruelty. Especially notice the crown, because sin always crowns us with thorns. So proceeding through this crisis, we find three things here at Gabbatha. Number one, we have a picture of what sin does. Christ was deserted, and that is our fate apart from Christ. Jesus was mocked and despised and rejected, and the same things that we become through sin. I have no doubt that the devil possessed and did a lot to utilize and use those Roman centurions and soldiers as agents of his cruelty on the body of Christ. I have no doubt about that. It's a picture for you that if you do not trust Jesus Christ for eternal life, that is what awaits you in hell. And we tend to think about it as a burning place, and I'm sure that's part of it too. We know that it's an isolated place because it's total separation, segregation from God, but I don't think Dante had it half wrong when he pictured it as a place of cruel torment and punishment. As the devil shows, as he inserts some of his demons into these men, and it is a picture of the ultimate conclusion of what sin works in our lives, in our communities, in our city. The same things we become through sin, Christ on the cross is a complete type or a living picture of what you will become if sin is left alone, if sin is left unconfessed. But Christ on the stone pavement where Pilate's judgment seat is at is a picture of the cruelty of that sin as it leads us to death. Sin's only throne is a mock one. His only crown is a painful one. His only reward is our sorrow and our shame. Here at Gabbatha, mocked by the soldiers, we see everything sin will do to us. We're left to wonder how people could ever act like they did and take pride in it. Number two, we have a picture of the world's estimate of Christ. Look at verse 22, Matthew 27, verse 22. Pilate saith unto them, "What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ?" They all say unto him, "Let him be crucified." And the governor said, "Why? What evil hath he done?" But they cried out the more, saying, "Let him be crucified." Well, I would have spoken up if I had been part of that crowd, and I would have contradicted the crowd on his behalf. Really? Do you speak up now? Well, I wouldn't have let him be maligned like that. Really? Well, what if your job depended on it? What if your life depended on it? What if your family depended on it? You would have done just like Pilate. He was out to maintain the peace, preserve harmony and diversity, and above all, the glory of the empire. You would have killed Jesus just to silence the voice of God. So verse 24 says, when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. The world thinks nothing of our Christ. Pastors today mock Christ by preaching Christ, but yet saying that the Old Testament is full of myths. And saying things like, well, since all truth must be God's truth, we need to take the guesses of psychology and we need to read the success of divination back into our Bible in order to replace the biblical authority that we're throwing out. They do spiritually what the soldiers here did literally. They put Christ in a purple robe. But since they are as skeptical as Sadducees, it is a mock robe. It is not true reverence that belongs to him. I hear them sometimes, especially in the conference rooms of what is called polite society, because I've been involved in some level in academia for decades now. You know, I'm the president of the board for a charter school. So you get to rub shoulders with a number of academics throughout the state and even throughout the country. And, you know, they'll speak politically correct with a kind of patronizing respect to the Savior of the world. They call him a good man, and they say they study his teachings, or they even live by his golden rule. And then, as if they're about to declare themselves the chief intellect in Athens, they go on to say, but now as for his church, speaking of the church for which he died, I have no place for that. Well, maybe at Easter. You know, it's all right for those who need it. The substitutionary atonement of Christ for sin is totally ignored by their gospel. They are imitating the Roman soldiers who set Christ on an old chair and then bowed down to him. Worst of all, there are those in our own assembly who hold the truth but hold it in unrighteousness. They come to the communion table pretending they love him, but their heart is far from him because they don't love the neighbor next to them. And so they allow Christ no real control of their lives. Some who are saved degrade their lives by immorality, by drunkenness. They're guilty of dishonest business. They live completely graceless lifestyles. They maybe are looking completely graceful, but then they don't give. They don't tithe. They don't support that church for which he died. They put mock garments of royalty on him. They feel no loyalty to him. And so finally, number three, we have a picture of how we need to act. In one era, we have the world tying martyrs to the stake and lighting them on fire. In our age, the world hoists us on petards and poles of ridicule and contempt instead. But the spirit is the same. Nothing has changed for you that was not true of every single believer down through history. Two things are clear from considering Christ at Gabbatha. First, letter A, none of us should chase after approval from or influence over the world. The world always chooses the guilty criminal and rejects the innocent ambassador. That has not changed. We should not be out to please the world or care what they think of us. Second, letter B, none of us should bother about being scorned. Turn to John chapter 19. We need to scorn scorn. Does the world laugh at you? Well, then laugh at the world's laughter. Say to the world, do you despise me? Hey, my forefathers were despised by your sword. My spiritual parents despised your dungeons. My spiritual ancestors despised your torture. My spiritual lineage despised the fire at your stake, so I will not tremble. My Lord was so shamed and scoffed at. Any sarcasm, any embarrassment I have to endure is only a compliment in comparison to what happened to him. We say, but I've been misrepresented. Oh, like that's a new thing. Why, you think you're better than Jesus? I mean, what's the big deal? Oh, but they say such rude things. And they have this way of looking at me, and it just really hurts my feelings. All right, but did they ever crown you with thorns? Yet even if they did crown you with thorns, the points are already broken off because Christ already wore it. So there's no way that you're going to get all the sharpness if he suffered any of the agony. So even if the ungodly do mock you, it's not going to be with that refined irony that the soldiers mocked Jesus here in John chapter 19 when they said in verse 3, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they smote him with their hands. A German regiment was stationed in Judea at the time. Hard-bitten, tough, professional Roman legionaries. They were strong, unfeeling men, ready to shed blood at a moment's notice. Human compassion had been tamped out by the stern discipline. They were iron instruments of an iron empire, already chafing at having drawn the assignment in that hot, flea-ridden, fly-ridden, God-forsaken place called Palestine. If they were there, they were thrown in among a strange and offensive people. Nobody could understand them. And there was always that threat of terrorism, that stealthy assassination at the hand of the Sicarii. So a Roman soldier cursed his fate if he'd been assigned to the last outpost that civilized men deemed worthy to rule. Turn to Mark chapter 15. They found little pleasure in Palestine, and so they took entertainment, they took sport wherever they could find it. One pleasure, a wicked one, a terrible pleasure it was to have a convicted death row inmate turned over to them so that he could become the butt of their jokes and the target of their pain and the object of their barracks humor, and he could suffer all the vulgarity of their stored up obscenity for being made to serve so far off the beaten path of history. Verse 16 of Mark 15 says, "And the soldiers led him away into the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole band. And so they took him. Pilate's military detachment let him off. They brought him over to the barracks where there was no controlling legal authority and no supervisor to keep them restrained. And here the Lord became fair game for whatever brand of gutter humor, obscenity, and outrage of his person that they could visit on him. A thread of rumor had run through the barracks, carried by those who had been stationed at the trial. The charge was that he claimed to be a king. So they decided the theme of their entertainment would be a mock coronation. So first they stripped him of his own clothes," Mark tells us in Mark 15, verse 17, "and they clothed him with purple. They went into their lockers to get an old purple cloak, part of a Roman soldier on dress parade. But this one was worn, it was tattered, it was old, it was a faded robe whose color had been overshadowed now by the crimson of Jesus' own blood. A king? A king," says he. "So they flung that cloak around his shoulders. In any crowd of mockers, there's always a rivalry among fools. So one of the soldiers is more daring. He goes outside the barracks and he finds this wiry bush crawling up the side wall of the barracks. And it was all thorny, but that didn't matter. That even made it better. He cut it with his sword, and he started to weave it into a crown," verse 17, "and plaited a crown of thorns and put it about his head. O sacred head surrounded by crown of piercing thorn, O bleeding head so wounded, reviled, and put to scorn. They jammed it down slowly until small rivulets of blood started flowing down his brow. Draws our mind to another hymn by Isaac Watts. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?" And then in mock worship, verse 18 tells us, they began to bow and began to salute him. "Hail, King of the Jews!" Gales of uncouth, scornful laughter reverberated through that hall. "Go out and weave a crown for Christ, and even though it's just the poor, fading flowers of your Laodicean ministry, you need to go out and weave your own crown. As long as it's watered by a heart's love for Christ, it'll be accepted." Another soldier said, "Well, a king has to have a scepter." So he ran out and he found a reed and he stuck it in Jesus' hands, verse 19, "and they smote him on the head with a reed and did spit upon him, and bowing their knees, worshipped him. When they tired of that sport and their humor wore thin, Peter tells Mark to tell us in verse 20, Then when they had mocked him, they took off the purple from him and put his own clothes on him and led him out to crucify him. That cloak that had hardened with clotted blood to his back. So they ripped off. I had somebody ask me one time, well, how come in one gospel it says it's purple, one says it's crimson, or one says it's something else? You know what? It started off one color, it changed to a totally another. And then when they ripped it off his back, it reopened the wounds. They put his own clothes back on. Now we know how different clothes can become a disguise. Different clothing will raise doubts about the identity of an individual. But the people in the street, they now saw him not arrayed in the mock purple robe and reed, but wearing his own clothes, a garment they recognized because it was without seam. They said immediately, here's a man who healed the sick. This is a man who raised the dead. This is the mighty teacher who stood on the mountaintop and taught down in the temple courts and preached with more authority than the scribes and the Pharisees. Jesus put back on his own clothes, so there was no shadow of doubt, like the Muslims claim today, that it was not really Jesus that was crucified, that someone was substituted in his place. No, that's why it says specifically he was in his own clothes. The intense hatred of the scribes and the Pharisees would not allow any substitution to be made. In his own clothes, he shouldered the cross that proclaimed his guilt and indicated his fate. In his own clothes, he asserted his role as our Redeemer. In his own clothes, he accomplished his mission as our Savior. In his own clothes, he climbed that little rise of ground called Golgotha because it looked so gothic, so much like a skull. In his own clothes, he went to Calvary and he opened a way to God. Jesus paid for all our sin and made things not just temporarily right, but all right, eternally right. Nothing left undone. Nothing can be added. On no other day does Jesus have to go back and add to that work because somebody new got born or somebody already born got worse. It's all right now. It is all right now. When we see him in his own clothes as the captain of our salvation, when we see him in his own clothes as the redeemer of the world, when we see him in his own clothes as our Passover sacrifice, when we see him in his own clothes as our purchase price at the gates of hell, when we see him in his own clothes offering eternal life by grace, if only we put our faith in his finished work, a prayer of forgiveness must certainly rise from our hearts. As in the words again of Isaac Watts, was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in when Christ, the mighty maker, died for man, the creature's sin. The New Testament says Jesus, in the mystery of God, took upon himself our sins. He met in his death the cost of destroying your sin. With these cruel soldiers, these coarse mockers, Jesus took it all, Jesus paid it all, and Jesus changed it all. I love my Jesus. He changes hurt to healing. I love my Jesus. He changes poison of sin to medicine of grace. I love my Jesus. He changes the crown of thorns into a crown of life for everybody who will look to him. I love my Jesus. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Jesus will soon one day appear again in his own clothes. No longer with an old faded red cloak around his shoulders. No longer mocked by soldiers. No longer in handcuffs and chains on his wrist. No longer with a crown of thorns on his brow. No longer with pain lining his face. No longer with the hurts of the world on his heart. We will see him in the glory of his sonship. We will see him in the beauty of his holiness. We will see him as heaven's true king, victor over the grave and admired by angels. Shall we not own him as our king today and say, thank you, Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for every tear. Thank you for every sorrow. Thank you for every ache. Thank you for every heartbreak. Thank you for every pain. Thank you for my rescue. Thank you. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of Thy name. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed for me. Turn to Luke 22. Because in just a matter of minutes, all hell is going to break loose and the life of heaven's hero and earth's emancipator, our Lord and liberator, Jesus Christ. Hell will break through in his life, and a few hours earlier, whenever Jesus was betrayed, one of his homeboys, as he was betrayed by Judas, his homeboy there in the garden, and arrested, he said in Luke 22, verse 53, "When I was daily with you in the temple, you stretched forth no hands against me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness." Have you ever been in that hour with the power of darkness? Have you ever been there where the powers of darkness were granted 60 minutes to work their worst hell? Can I just paint a picture on the palette of your anointed imagination? Storms are forming and foreboding. Can you not see the lightning already flashing outside the upper room and playing games against the black bosom of that dismal night? Can you not hear the clap of thunder as the hour belonging to darkness finally struck? And this finally brings us to number three, Golgotha. The night watches of Gethsemane, the flash of torches in the night, the kiss of the traitor, the Lord's arrest. Still in the evening's blackest darkness, the arraignment before the high priest, the hours of waiting and tension while wicked people worked their will against him, the appearance in front of the high priest and the council in the morning, the palace of the Roman procurator with that strange interview between Jesus and Pilate, being withdrawn from the rabble into a quiet judgment hall, the trip from the hall of Pilate to the palace of Herod, the rough handling by Herod's brutal bodyguard, the trip back to Pilate, the scenes where Pilate tries to save him as the priests and the natives of Jerusalem riot for his blood, the scourging, the way of sorrows. They all lead us now to the climax of the crisis of the crucifixion. Nicodemus wanted to know the way to be born again, and Jesus' answer was an Old Testament picture of the crisis of the cross. Many statements made by Jesus are only understandable now in light of the crisis of the cross. The Pharisees demanded Jesus tell them where was his authority for cleansing the temple, and his answer, which was misunderstood, was the crisis of the cross. Because Jesus said the final sign would be casting death out of its domain, providing evidence of victory in that realm by his bodily return to life. The value of everything he was saying, everything he was doing in ministry was going to be created by the crisis of the cross. Turn to John chapter 12. God spoke from heaven three times, each one as Christ was consenting to the crisis of the cross. At his baptism, Jesus identified with us sinners, even though he was not a sinner. John the Baptist objected to that, and Jesus said, "No, we've got to do this to fulfill all righteousness." And those waters foreshadowed that overwhelming death flood that would surround his soul. Secondly, on the Mount of Transfiguration, he gave his consent again, not to take the shortcut to heaven, which he could have done, but instead to go down from that mountain and to accomplish his exodus at the crisis of his passion. God spoke from heaven on both of those times. Now there was this third time. Look at John chapter 12, verse 27. "Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I unto this hour. Father, glorify thy name." Then came there a voice from heaven, saying, "I both glorified it and will glorify it again." The people, therefore, that stood by and heard it, said that it thundered. Others said An angel spake to him. Jesus answered and said, This voice came not because of me or for your sakes. It is for the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. This he said, signifying what death he should die. You know, one thing that proves that Christianity is superior to every other religion is the crisis of the cross. Every major religion of the world is either ethical in nature, like Buddhism and Confucius, or it's superstitious in nature, like Catholicism and Hinduism and Islam. Only Christianity is redemptive. So it is impossible to live by the ethics of Christianity without the dynamic crisis of the cross. The cross solves two problems which have no other solution than this crisis. Two problems solved by the cross. Number one, how can a holy God justify sinners? How can holiness justify unholiness? And that justification has to be more than just forgiveness, because in justification, a soul has to be declared that it is restored to its original purity. So much so, there is no spot, nor blemish, nor any such thing. No stain, either on the character of the person or on their record. How does that happen without the cross? The second problem solved, number two, is how can righteousness be delivered to unrighteous men and women? Now turn to 1 Corinthians 15. How can a man or woman be both justified by God and sanctified in his or her practical experience? Once made new again, how can they possibly stay clean? The answer is in the cross. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3, For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That's the first plank in the platform of Christianity. Most people want to be remembered for the life they lived. Jesus wants to be known for the death he died. That's why he said, back up to chapter 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. That's why Paul says, Paul records Jesus is saying in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 25, This do ye as oft as ye drink of it in remembrance of me. For as oft as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. So by observing the Lord's Supper in memory, we look into his face again. In memory, we put our finger into the imprint of the nails. In memory, we step into the upper room to recline at the couch where they perform the Last Supper. And then in reality, we're able to live Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. And I'm crucified in Christ, and I live, yet not I, but Christ. I live by the faith of the Son of God. So remembering Christ brings him to you. All down through the ages, holding his portrait up to your mind allows you to see his heart beating out love for you. It assures you that he still loves you, even though now he's ascended to his Father's throne on high. And then your love can flow back to him more freely in return. It says, forget everything except for the Lord. It recalls you from yourself. It says, come back, cumbered Martha. Sit at my feet. Return even from the battlefield and look on your captain and redeemer. Don't remember doctrine, remember me. The cross is the heart and the core of the gospel, and the heart and the core of how you can continue to stay clean after you got saved. So here's our first point for study. If you preach and you have no cross, your pulpit is spiritually demagnetized. I don't know what else to call it. Whereas the remembrance of the cross is the prolonging and the extending of faith. We need faith to replace our forgetfulness, specifically about the death of the cross. So get Mark chapter 15 in your left hand and 2 Corinthians 5 in your right. 2 Corinthians 5, Mark 15. We normally define death as separation of the soul from the body, and that is true, but it doesn't get us below the surface. Two elements are extended in the Lord's Supper, and they are designed to teach us not just the death of Christ, that he atoned for our sin. The bread represents his body broken for us. His bones were not broken, but his body was. And there are more nerves in your muscle than there is in your bones. So for his body to be broken, his muscle, his ligaments, his sinews torn, represented excruciating pain. So the broken bread represents his suffering, but the wine represents his spilt blood. And blood in the flesh equals life, but blood spilt out means death. So it was not just his death, but his passion that was important. And this is where the kernel of this crisis is uncovered, because death is more than just separation of the soul from the body. So here's our second point for study. Since death is the wages of sin, then death is the separation of the soul from God. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For God hath made Christ to be sin for us, Christ who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. That is the kernel of this crisis. In the cross, God turned his back on his son. Somehow God created a crack in the Trinity wide enough to fit you and me inside it. So now Mark 15, verse 34. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. That is the moment Jesus tasted death for every man. The agony of his soul plus the death on the cross made a complete atonement for sin. It is the bread and the wine. It is the suffering body and the spilt blood. No one else but him could die for another person's sin, because no one else but him would feel as sharply as him the separation from God. So Christ came to do what no man could do, either for himself or for anyone else. But he could do it, because here's our third point for study. Christ's death stored up merit he did not need, so God could bestow it on those who did not deserve. Maybe the most we can certainly know about this crisis is expressed in this seventh saying from the cross. All we can really know of the pain comes from his own lips. The first three sayings on the cross are uttered during the first 3 hours, and they show his insight into life. The last four sayings, and you'll see I've given you a chart on your handout that kind of summarizes the seven sayings through the cross. The last four sayings are made during the final 3 hours, and they express his personal experience in total loneliness. There's never been a preacher like the dying Savior. There's never been a pulpit like the rugged cross. There's never been a sermon like these seven sayings. So much so that this is so much beyond me. It's so much over me. I'm so scared to do this, but I am tempted to take 6 or 7 weeks leading up to Easter and preaching each Sunday on one of these sayings. Jesus started with his enemies. He ended with himself. His hands were nailed to a cross, but he died like a king, reigning in death just like he had in life. Two shouts express everything that we could ever know about his sublime sufferings this side of eternity. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And secondly, I thirst. Because here's where we get clarity from the cross. Neither complaint nor appeal, but a mere statement of fact. These words were uttered so we can know how much we can never know. But three things are clear. Number one, sin at its bottom line, because this is where Jesus reached the final conclusion with iniquity. It's a final and finished work that he fulfilled. The logical, irresistible, irrevocable bottom line result of sin is to be God forsaken. Sin in its harvest means to be abandoned by God. Man reaps the final wages of sin when God gives him up. That is the final penalty of sin. Sin is alienation from God by choice, and hell is realization of that chosen alienation. Mark chapter 15, verse 34. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? That is hell. Jesus did not go to hell, but he suffered hell, because no other human being has been totally forsaken and still living, still alive. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. Jesus took hold of sin and made it his own. He accepted our responsibility. Only God himself could bear sin and then carry it to the throne and then sprinkle it right on the mercy seat. So this time, instead of telling Mark what to tell us, Peter tells us himself in 1 Peter 2, verse 24. that Christ, his own self, bear our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Bending his head and bowing under the weight, he gathered in his own heart the awful isolation of hell, the result of sin in this world. He took our curse, being made a curse for us, as he accepted that as his own. He then created a world of merit that he did not need. And what he acquired does not need now needs to be freely distributed to those who exercise faith in him. That's why we go with the gospel, because he's taken their place. Second, this is number two. A second point of clarity is this: sorrow at its deepest spot. Jesus plumbed the depths of grief. We make a big deal of that today in terms of psychology. They make a big deal of it. It used to be guilt, and Freud said, you got to get rid of your guilt, you have psychosis because of guilt. So if we can just eliminate this idea of sin, you won't have guilt, you won't be psychotic. To use that type of language admits that there could be sin, so you got to take the morality out of it. And so psychology today says that the problem's not guilt, the problem is grief. Actually, you haven't grieved. And so grief is a consciousness that you miss something. And the deepest depth of that sorrow is lacking God. There's no grief like that sorrow. In perfect harmony with the eternal purpose of God, Jesus entered into a realm of profound pain because of grief. And then third, this is number three, third point of clarity, silence in its inexplicable mystery. Jesus was himself overwhelmed in secrecy. Turn to Isaiah chapter 53. Sin at its bottom line, sorrow at its deepest point, and silence in the unexplainable mystery of God being in agony. He states the fact he is forsaken and stricken, but in the midst of that experience, he asks why. Other times in his life, he asks how long. In the withdrawal of his Father's presence, which is the ultimate price of sin, and in the depths of his sorrow over that, there is an enshrouding of his spirit in silence. No voice, no vision, no sympathy, no explanation, no promise, no hope in those final 3 hours. Such infinities cannot be measured by human weights. But that is what Jesus makes Jesus God. And while the unfolding of this mystery in his passion is unknowable, the words of Isaiah start to sound sadly appropriate. Chapter 53, verse 4. Surely he hath borne our griefs. Surely he hath carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. With his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him that iniquity. Our wandering, our straying, our turning away from God, all those years, all that time. He should have had our life. He should have had our glory. Going to him, look down in verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. I think he looked down through history and he saw that I would get saved. And he said, I don't know why he would say this, but I think that he said, you know, that makes it worth it. I love him so much that makes it worth it all. And he said the same thing about you, because if you're saved, he saw the same thing about you. And it says here, that he shall be satisfied, that by his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many. In other words, it was the knowledge of what he was doing, what he was going through, who he was enduring it for, the knowledge of what was going on there on that cross. Through the knowledge of that, he was willing to suffer. And it says here, for he shall bear their iniquities. He stood where I should stand. The pains of hell that were my portion got hold on him. They were vicarious sufferings, they were expiatory sufferings, and they were atoning sufferings. So let's note these three theological distinctions, because by definition, the passion of his sufferings was first letter A, vicarious, because he stood in man's place when he suffered. That's what the word vicarious means. The penalty he bore had no relation to the life that he lived. And since he bore it, then we're free from it. Second, this is letter B, it is expiatory, because he put away human sin when he suffered. That's what the word expiation means. Jesus exhausted sin. He made it to not be. It was an expiation. It was a carrying away of our transgressions. And third, this is letter C, it was a substitutionary atonement. He was atoning because he restored lost fellowship with God when he suffered. Turn to Luke chapter 23. Spurgeon says the plan of salvation is just this, that Christ shall take the sinner's place and suffer in the sinner's room instead what the sinner ought to have suffered. The very pith and marrow of the gospel lies in that word, substitution. Christ, who knew no sin, was made sin for us that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. We take Christ's place because Christ took our place. He stood in the room, the place, and the stead of lost sinners. Through his sufferings, Jesus dealt with everything separate that separated man and God. He has now made reconciliation possible so we can forever live in communion with God. It was three things. It was in our place, it was a putting away, and it was a payment. So here's our fourth point for study. If people will not come into contact with the cross, then sin is still an element in force. And it is so great that no one is able to escape it. Nobody can avoid that consequence. Luke chapter 23, did I say we'll turn to Luke 23? Luke 23, verse 38. And a superscription also was written over him in letters of Greek and Latin and Hebrew. This is the King of the Jews. He started his march at the Praetorium, shouldering the crossbeam on which he would die. But there was a black man from Cyrene named Simon. He had traveled 800 miles to get to Jerusalem, and the Roman soldiers were in a hurry. So they conscripted this strong, tall man to carry that cross. Jesus marched in his own clothes, so they were certain it was him. But he did not carry his own cross because he was not really guilty. And so the bragging apostle, Simon Peter, is replaced by an unknown Simon from far away. And it's clear when you compare scripture with scripture that he not only carried that cross, he came to trust in Jesus for himself, and he went home to lead his wife and his sons to faith in the Lord. Judas pleased himself and lost his soul. Pilate pleased the people and passed an unjust sentence. Jesus did what always pleased the Father and brought us salvation. Look at Matthew chapter 27, Matthew 27. And then we'll go to one more place, Colossians chapter 1, and then we'll be done. Matthew chapter 27, verse 45. Now from the sixth hour, that's about noon, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour, about 3 p.m. I mean, right in the middle of the day, and right in the middle of their birth, while ogling the naked body of Jesus, at that moment, darkness fell. When Jesus was born, midnight was turned into midday by the star and the singing angels. When he was crucified, midday turned to midnight, the only day that has known night twice, because it was not meet that Jesus should be gawked at as he trod the winepress alone. It's as if God were saying to us, do you want to see this crisis? You know what? You wouldn't even understand it if you did. But the blackness of darkness will picture it for you. You cannot follow him. You're not in your element here. You will lose yourself in that cave. It is only my son who has endured my wrath who can travel this road. There was darkness for 3 hours, but the dying Savior was the light of the world. And when he said, "It is finished," then the torch of the sun was rekindled again, showing that the wrath of God had passed up until the actual death of Christ. If someone wanted eternal salvation, they couldn't have found it. Nobody found it. Nobody ever found it until the death of Christ. Because up until that point, all you could get, the best you could get, was remission of sins, not their removal. All you could get was their covering by the blood of rams and goats every year. But you could not get their removal. You could not get eternal salvation, eternal life, eternal security. Christ was put in darkness because no man by his own schemes could ever have found the plan of salvation. Our job is to tell those who are still in the dark the story of this crisis and the story of Jesus' passion for them. We've got to be carrying the light into the night. Turn to Colossians chapter 1. As we close tonight, in the few moments we have left, I'm going to ask you to examine your Christianity. I know you have a lot of it, but what is its quality? Can it stand the test of contempt and scientific sarcasm? You know, it cannot, apparently cannot, in a lot of broader evangelicalism today. And, you know, the Kofers, I can understand if they don't know this because they are so far out of the country for so much time. But many of you in here may know this. In a lot of evangelical Christianity today, they've totally capitulated on biblical authority, which means that they're now capitulating on faith. They are giving up the idea that the Old Testament is anything but myths and fables. At least some of it is myths and fables. Totally the idea of special creation is out. I'm not even talking about the difference between 6 literal 24-hour days and days of ages. Not even talking about that. I'm just talking about the whole idea of special creation at all versus evolution. So that's out because they don't like the sarcasm of the scientists against them. Archaeological evidence that they think they don't see to support Old Testament stories. So all of that is out. They give up on all of that. They try to hold on to Christ. They try to hold on to evangelical label and preaching of the gospel. I think we're in the worst state we could possibly be in and as Laodicean Christians today, in Laodicean Christianity. Because we have our leading lights of megachurch fundamentalism, megachurch evangelicalism, you know, who claim to plant churches, which is really just a worship of their face in another place. And they stand up and say, well, you know, that's not really true, and we can't really vouch for that, and, you know, that's not really correct about the Bible, but we still believe in Jesus. And so their favorite theologian, N.T. Wright, you know, he will say that he believes in and defends substitutionary atonement, and yet he does not believe in imputation. So he doesn't believe that the righteousness of Christ is imputed to me and my sin is imputed to the Lord. He doesn't, so he believes, and I can't even understand that. I can't understand that, you know, because even though he's an evangelical, he's an Anglican, he's got to have some way to support the idea that you have to be baptized in his church to be in that boundary marker of the elect and those who are Christians. That's how crazy it is out there, because evangelical leaders follow that type of thought. Someone who has a PhD from Cambridge, meaning he knows Hebrew, he knows Greek, he knows Latin, he knows patristics, so he knows what all the church fathers said. There is no greater waste of time than to read the church fathers. Why would I want to waste my time with the recordings of the transactions and of business of the imperial church? Makes no sense to me. But he knows all of that. So he writes a book on the authority of the Bible called The Last Word. Kind of double entendre, I think, because he thinks his word is the last one. And he'll say that, you know, there's no authority but God. So the Bible's not an authority. Only God is an authority. But then he's got a PhD from Cambridge. He can't tell me how God mediates his authority through the Word of God. Because he doesn't believe that he does. So we're left with nothing. We're left with ashes. We've taken everything Christ won on the cross, and we want to sell our soul for a mess of pottage. So examine your Christianity. Can it stand the test of chronic sickness or acute depression? What are you doing in the common trials of life? If you faint when adversity is small, what are you going to do when the flooding of the Jordan comes? Jesus Christ becomes the mirror of the church. What the head endured, every member of the body is able to suffer in their own measure. So Paul says for himself, watch, Colossians 1 verse 24. Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you. Why? Because Paul says, as I suffer, trying to get the gospel to you and trying to make sure you stay straight on all these things, I fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church. So as we see Christ suffered in our place, let's learn how to love him in our afflictions. Because here's our final point for study. In this life, affliction endured is the measure of the test of your affection. So practice the passion of Christ. Your triumph will be in your sufferings. Your strength will be in your weakness. You have to expect to earn the victory in defeat and even death. It will be when you finally bow your head of pride and you give up yourself, and you can finally say, it is over. Expect the darkness. And if you have it, don't question, don't wonder about it. Just wait till the night passes, till its hour is over and the light shines again. I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of thy face. Content to let the world go by, to know no shame nor loss. My sinful self, my only shame. My glory, all the cross. Go ahead and stand and grab your neighbor by the hand. Next week, we'll look at crisis number 7, his resurrection and ascension. And that will close out our study of the life of Christ together. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you for this topic. Lord, I don't even know how to stand before people and talk about it adequately. And Lord, I'm ashamed of the incomplete, imperfect picture we've given of this crisis tonight. And Lord, I apologize for not somehow having even more of your spirit and more insight, something more to say, some way that will draw us in more to the comprehension of your son's sufferings on our behalf. And all that they won for us and what they can do through us if we will simply now be crucified in him. So Father, what I lack and what I have not been able to do in any good measure, Lord, by your Spirit make up for. God, I'm counting on your grace, not my eloquence, not my insight, not my knowledge. Lord, I'm counting on your grace to work in people's hearts. And Lord, that you would lift us all up to the level of getting your gospel to the lost, giving glory to God by his son Jesus, through his body, which is this church, because that is your eternal purpose for us. We ask it tonight in Jesus' precious and powerful name. Amen. If you're here and you're a visitor and I've not got a chance to meet you yet, come up and introduce yourself to me. If you have any spiritual needs or questions, come here to the front. And love you. We'll see you Wednesday night. You're dismissed.